Morning, Pasco.
Good morning, guys. How you doing?
Good.
You guys can hear me okay and see me okay?
Yep.
Yep.
All right. Just going to wait a couple minutes here, and we'll get some other guys on here as they're starting to join. How's everything in your part of the world, guys? Is everything starting to get back to normal again a little bit?
Not even close.
Oh, geez, really? I know they're starting to do some stuff here in Vancouver, but just a couple of rinks are open at this particular point. But they're doing it slowly, that's for sure.
Well, Michigan hasn't even started discussing any of that.
Oh God, yeah, she's pretty hard lined. I'll tell you that much. We're watching her up here in Canada. Yeah. And, oh my God, she's really vying for that VP spot, isn't she?
Oh, she's putting in a pretty good bid for it. So
she's working overtime, that's for sure.
She's holding firm.
Yeah, I have a feeling that she's going to want to get out of there as fast as they possibly can.
For sure,
people are going to get angry.
Oh, they're already there.
Yeah, oh yeah. Let's see who we have on here. Hi, TJ. We got Tyler. We got Izzy, David. All right, Nick, Lauren. Hi, Lauren. David, Adam Billings. How you doing, buddy? 19292. Okay, Darren. All right. Hi, Angela. How you doing? Dave, all the way from Germany. What time is it? 4 a.m. over there or what?
Yeah, my.
What time is it?
It's 8 p.m. Here in Germany.
Well, that's not bad. No date, I guess, tonight, eh?
It's barbecue time.
Barbecue time. There you go.
Yes, awesome. Exactly.
That's awesome. Well, it's good to see you, buddy. It's really good to see you. You look like a hockey coach right now with your hat on and everything. You're ready to rock and roll. Yeah. We're going to get started here. I'm sure we're going to get some people kind of ding in and want to be a part of the process. So we'll I'll check periodically, but I want to respect your time as well. We've got a good group of people here, and I want to make sure that we have my screen being shared and everybody. Sorry about that. I want to make sure I have my screen being shared so you guys have the opportunity to see the presentation that we got going on. So let's see. I just want to check really quickly. Yeah, that's the one. All right. Can everybody see my screen?
Yep.
Thumbs up. Yep. All right. So what we're going to do here is we're going to talk a little bit about the reverse VH. Okay. And a couple of the different varying degrees of the reverse VH and how it's kind of progressed over the last little while. I have the opportunity, obviously, of working with a lot of National Hockey League goaltenders. And that was through some great contacts that I've had. And it's been a really awesome opportunity to do that. And through that discovery, what I've found is that there is no finish line when it comes to any technique, or especially with the reverse VH. Linda is a gal from Sweden. She's actually the one that coined SMS, or skate on post. She's a young coach that coaches the national team over in Sweden, the male national team. And she's very, very good at what she does. She saw a 9-year-old teaching and an 11-year-old, I think it was, teaching a national team goaltender how to do an RVH. And then she went over and kind of listened to the kids and then ultimately started coining what is called today SMS or the RVH. Now, what I hope to share with you as we start talking about the reverse VH is that there are a lot of variations to how the reverse VH is executed. There's some goaltenders on this line that I haven't worked with or trained with, and your goaltending coach will explain the RVH to you, and maybe they'll pick up some new ideas from this presentation, or maybe they'll chime in and share some thoughts and ideas. The whole idea of this is really about sharing and helping you guys understand, and helping you gals understand, parents understand, and coaches understand that there's a lot of different ways and techniques to execute an RVH, and that all comes down to specific situations and strategies. Okay, so sorry, I've got three more here. There we go. And so what we're going to do is we're going to move forward here today and take a look here. And then you can see here that this is a Tuukka Rask. I hope he doesn't retire. I had the opportunity to watch him here at the World Juniors in Vancouver and get, I think it was about a 55 save shutout against one of the teams here. And I was just mesmerized. He was a phenomenal goalie, only 18 years old. And, you know, ironically, Toronto drafted him and then they traded him off to Boston. What a mistake. But anyway, he's a pretty phenomenal goaltender, and hopefully we'll get a number of years out of Tuukka Rask. But as you can see here, he's you guys can see my, I'm assuming my mouse moving around. Can you see that? So you can see he's using a skate on post here, and he's got his blocker covering this little triangular hole that we create. And there's a whole lot of space up here. We're going to go through and we're going to show you from the start of RVH through to some of the latest techniques in RVH. And if we have some questions, feel free to chime in and ask the questions as we go through. So basically what I'm going to show you here is where the first RVH started. This isn't the first RVH video, but this is straight from Sweden. And I'm going to share it. Just watch how the coach is teaching this and giving you an idea. So, I mean, I could turn the sound up, but it's all in Swedish. So unless you understand it, you're not going to understand it. But Sweden, I've learned that they call it what it is. No,
why is it?
Hey guys, can you hear me? Can you guys hear me okay?
Yep.
All right, somebody, I heard somebody there real quick. But the reason why you can't hear this video is because it's in Sweden, and SMS stands for skate on post. So Sweden calls it what it is, one leg down, one leg up. That's what they call a vertical horizontal or a VH. So if we look here, predominantly you're looking at Swedish goaltenders using skate on post, and they use toe box on post. And this is from a number of years ago when the RVH first started coming out. And they like to videotape from behind the net so that you can see where the holes and openings are. And you're going to find that the differences between Swedish goaltenders, Finnish goaltenders, and Canadian U.S. goaltenders are Swedish goaltenders are very, very good skaters, and they're very, very blocky style goalies. They're very into maximizing their body space and covering the holes. That's why you find them a little bit more stiff on the top. And they slide over and box out. And that's really where this comes out, as you can start seeing how the goalie, there's a hinge there, kind of a slight hinge there. You can see they're trying new techniques to just try to hinge out, which those new techniques are quite old. And then they started going, how can we transition from post to post? And in today's world, we're not going to be, you know, coming way out here and then turning back into an RVH most of the time, because they're in the area surrounding the blue paint. And if they're in the area surrounding the blue paint, you can't chase pucks away from the posts, because ultimately what will end up happening is they'll create time and space around you. So just showing you some videos of how the Swedes were practicing the RVH, moving from post to post. They've got tremendous hinge power. They also have good double pivots, and they're quite good at what they do. But again, their main objective is not so much to track the puck with their head like they're doing a lot in North America. They do track the puck very well, and they can see. The challenge is they stay really, really upright, and they don't get into the trajectory or disrupt the trajectory. Now we're going to get into a lot of goaltenders that were at the camp, at one of the camps that we've run down in the States with Dave and Mike and a bunch of other goalie coaches. This is Scott Darling. And what I want you to look at when you're looking at this video is I want you to see how many different techniques they're using, right? So here's Jimmy Howard. There's skate on post. There's toe box on post. There's toe box on post. Next one is Brian Elliott. So there's skate on post. There's toe box on post. There's toe box on post. There's toe box on post. Okay. This is a goaltender from the Rangers. There's skate on post. There's a pad in post, skate on post, pad in post. And then there's skate on post. So what I'm sharing with you guys is they're trying a lot of different tactics and techniques. And one of the best ways when you're practicing these tasks is to make sure that you go through drills like this, where you practice your skate on post, and then you practice your toe box on post and your pad in post. But remember, like, why do we have so many different ways to do it? You can see that Robin Lehner here, he had his glove side elbow inside the post. You'll see it here as he comes around. His glove side elbow now is outside the post. Here's Michael Hutchinson from the Maple Leafs. So there's a glove inside the post there. You see that? His elbow's inside the post. So you start looking at a lot of the different tactics. And what I look at it is a whole array of tactics and techniques that are out there that need to be organized in such a way that you can work it by situation. Does that make sense? If you've got a skate on post, that's a tactic. If you've got toe box on post, that's a tactic. If you've got pad in post, that's a tactic as well. So when you're looking at those types of tactics, is there a better situation for you to, is there a better situation for you to use these tactics, if that makes sense? So maybe it's an attack from below the goal line. Maybe it's an attack from the side of the net. Maybe it's a post-save recovery. Maybe it's the fact that you want to move back to your post and bump back out. So what I've added here, and hopefully if you're taking notes, you're able to kind of look at is, what is it that you want to accomplish? Are you trying to seal the ice? Are you trying to get a good solid post seal? You know, are you trying to get a lateral seal in the event that they decide to, you know, throw a fake to your RVH on one side and try to take you from east of the post to west of the post, meaning side to side? Or, you know, what do you want to accomplish in the Swedish style of RVH? And we talked about this quite in detail when the Swede goalie coaches came down to the network goaltending seminar that we hosted in Nashville. We asked them a lot of different questions about, okay, well, they were asking questions. Why are we leaning forward in certain situations? And that is to cut down the trajectory. Number one. Number two, we want to be able to have sight of the puck, which they clearly have sight of the puck, but they don't have access to the puck. So what ends up happening is you'll end up making a save off of your pad, and then it goes out into the slot. Or if it's down by your pad, you have to break away, lean over and cover the puck. So those are basic rules that we want to kind of move forward with when you're talking about, you know, strategies. So in this one, what are the risks? So is the person going to shoot high? Is the person going to attempt to shoot between your body and the post? Are they going to go for an east-west rebound, meaning they're going to shoot it on you and then grab the puck and try to go around you? You know, are you making it tough to access the net? And that really is really important for everyone to understand. And then the third aspect is, so what do you want to accomplish? What are the risks? The next one is going to be what drives the decision. So if you're talking about what drives the decision, I think this drives the decision in a lot of situations. Puck proximity. Where is the puck? If the puck is 25, 30, 40 feet away from the net, the top of the net at the crease is about 37 inches tall. Okay, so let's round it down to 36 or 3 feet above the ice at the hash mark, or sorry, at the edge of the crease. So if that puck is only 2 feet away from the top of the crease, the top of the net's not 36 inches anymore. The top of the net is much lower because the puck is closer. You become much bigger to the puck. So puck proximity will play a huge role. Is the puck above the goal line, below the goal line? Is it further away? Is it in tight? Is there a player back door? Are you trying to close down pucks? Things like that. In an RVH, you know, are there pass options? I explained this two seminars ago about Carey Price. And Carey Price now has broken it down to timing situations and things like that. The problem is in the NHL, and the higher you go in hockey, so if you're a young guy or if you're an older pro on here, the main objective here is that if you come up with a timing mechanism that they can take advantage of, then they will do that. So Carey's timing mechanism is the bottom of the circle. So if a player is coming from the blue line down and attacking the net, on an angle, he'll drop down into an RVH when the stick and the puck touches the bottom of the circle right at the hash or right in line with the dots. And I'll show you a diagram in a minute. So as soon as he does that, that releases the opposite side defenseman. So there's going to be a cross ice diagonal east-west pass and a one-timer from the D-man. So it's really, really important for you guys to recognize that these guys will videotape you. They'll recognize what you do. There's coaches on your team that may have played against you a couple of times before and remember what you like to do. You know, it starts at that basic level. And then as you move higher through junior, there's more video. Major junior, there's definitely lots of video. Then you get into American Hockey League, national program. I mean, when I was with the national program a couple of years ago with the national team, I had a whole year to pre-scout goaltenders. So I knew every nook and cranny. I knew how they're going to act in every sections of the ice. And I created scoring or scouting reports against them. And when the scouting reports are followed, it's not like shoot here. The scouting reports are how do we explore, emphasize a tendency or a weakness within a goalie? How do we exploit that tendency and recreate that tendency so we could take advantage of them? And it's quite an amazing, amazing thing. Rebounds and timing are also really important. What drives the decision? And I'm sure there's many more, and goalie coaches out here too will be able to add to that list. But we want to make sure we understand that those are really important when we're making decisions in the reverse VH. In 2016, the Ontario Hockey League, Ontario Minor Hockey said, oh, okay, well, when do you use this VH and reverse VH? So what they said was, when the puck is in the purple area, you're going to use your VH and RVH and prepare for a shot or pass. And then in the green, you can expect a pass and stand up in the net. So those were basic items that were taking place. Now, when I say that right now, there's already goalie coaches on here going, well, that's not true because you can do this and this. You're 100% right. The game is fluid. It's constantly moving. And the skills coaches are constantly analyzing what the goalie coaches are doing and vice versa. So it's always a cat and mouse game as to what you can do. So this is a game of reinvention. It's a game of change and adjustment. And you need to stay ahead of that curve all the time, because if you don't, then they recognize a tendency and take advantage of you. So this is what it looks like from our perspective. And it's a flowing change. This is the latest one that's in my book. But when you come down, what I was talking about before with Carey Price, if a player comes down here and then he's going to attack the net, as soon as the puck touches the edge of the circle right here in line with the faceoff dot, Price goes down because he's expecting that player to come in and attack him. The problem is that it's a setup play. So as that player comes down, Price attacks, and then this D comes right over here. And the player with the least amount of eyes on him or her is going to score the most goals. And you'll see that in a lot of the different tactics and techniques. Now, I know this is a lot to digest, but if we really focus our attention on the blue area below the goal line, so that's this area right in here. This area right in here is a great timing mechanism in the trapezoid for a player to start thinking about RVH. Because if we think about this, now everyone's different. So I don't want to, you know, stand on a pedestal and say everybody must do this, because it's going to change. It's like this whole process and strategy is going to continue to change and adjust. So as this player comes down now, in the past, it used to be RVH. And you're going to see in a video that I'm going to play of captured by Eddie Guay and another video that we've got off of from the National Hockey League, that when you come into this area, they know a lot of different things. For example, you've made the first move, so they know where your vulnerabilities are. When you drop down, the player without the puck that can receive a pass is already attacking the net in a variety of different ways as well. So those are things to really take into consideration. So when a player goes below the goal line, they can come up above the goal line and shoot. So what would likely be the most effective mechanism to use in this particular area to cover that slim area entrance to the net?
Just a VH.
A VH or an overlap, depending on if there's backside pressure, right? Pretty simple. So RVH would be down way below that. And again, if you are in an RVH and you're coming down this way, or the guy's starting to attack here, you're actually starting to make your first move and the puck is above the goal line. So those are things to take into consideration. And this is a game planning depth management chart. So when you're looking at things like, okay, if this player comes down here and I'm just focusing on these blue areas, this is what's going to happen. You know, he's either going to drive me here. He's going to take a shot from here. He's going to do a net drive. He's going to dip below the goal line and come back out. He's going to go below the goal line and pass out. Think about all the different options that can happen in that scenario. And you can build a game plan based on the six or seven different scenarios that can happen. And those six or seven different scenarios, like I talked about last week in zone two, there's eight. There's the shot, the net drive. There's the high pass, mid pass, net front pass, give and go pass, the rim. And then of course the eat or the freeze. And in doing that stuff, the game becomes so predictable that you know exactly what's, I can't even watch like an NHL hockey game anymore, because I know exactly what's going to happen when they come over the line, and you can see what the goalie's starting to compute. So as long as you are taking a vision and taking a snapshot of what's happening with scanning, you're going to do extremely well. So let's talk about some RVHs, and this is the glove side of RVH. So Carey Price has got a very interesting RVH. One of the ones, it's one of my favorite ones, especially when you're close to the net. But he does have his his glove inside the post. His elbow. Is that a good thing? Yeah, because there's two variations of it. The first one, when the elbow is inside the post, the puck is really, really close. And if the puck pops from the post out into the center area or the slot area, he's able to push off with both his arm and his pad and his head, which is driving that movement to the middle. And you'd be surprised. All you really need to do is move your head from the post to the middle and your whole body will start to move towards the center of the net. When it's outside the post, that player is coming in from below the goal line. And if they shoot up, you've actually created a bit of a triangle when you do that. So if you look at my elbow, you've created a triangle under there. Okay. So if you look at that picture below, not of Carey Price, you'll see there's the elbow inside the post, but there's still amount of daylight there where guys could take advantage. And then here's Ben Bishop here, just underneath the words. You can see that this is a kind of an awkward situation, and you can see he's looking below the goal line. Now, as a shooter, what do you see? You see the skate on post, you see the opening, and those are the areas they're going to try to drive. Now, how much stability is on this post? Well, you could say you've got an anchor here. You could say you've got an anchor on this foot, which is not as strong as, say, this particular one. But if they come in and jam this leg, I can guarantee you there's going to be some level of separation there, especially in minor hockey or in junior hockey. So it's really important for us to understand that, hey, if the elbow is on the outside, maybe we have the opportunity to hold that post a little more because we've got an anchor and we've got an elbow on the post that can help us kind of pinch that post off a little bit more. But there's a reason why they do it. It's not wrong to have your pad or your elbow inside the post. It's just a variation to get you to the center of the net much more effectively. The back of the hand here covers that space really, really nicely rather than opening up that glove. So, stick blade adjustment. Okay, so you can see Carey Price here, and he's got his blade facing outwards. Is that a good choice? Yeah, it'd be a good choice. Yeah. I mean, there's no need, having your heel pointed out and just having your pad there and opening up the back of your hands to a shot against you. There's nothing wrong with it. The puck's in front or on top of the goal line. If it's below the goal line, is that a good position? Can he adjust his blade to be more effective? The answer is yes. You can put your heel towards the puck. You can put your hand down on the ice and you can really protect yourself. Glove options. You can go in the post like this. You can go in the post and open. You can have your elbow outside the post with your hand and your glove open wide. So if the puck hits the back, it drops down when it's in tight. You definitely don't want to use that tactic when the guy is much further away, taking a really hard shot and taking that on the back of the hand. And then again, you probably wouldn't be in an RVH if that puck is way in the control section of the ice, which is over by the boards, which we're going to see a lot of in some of these advantages. So we talked about elbow options, elbow in, elbow out, hand down. You know, there's all kinds of things we can do here. Pad angles. Okay. 30% is one of the things that Alex Auld would talk about. You'd want to be in a position where you're somewhere in around the 30% mark so that you have access to the center. And in reality, 25 to 30% on an angle is a pretty good option because you just want to get to the center of the crease when the puck goes to the middle. You don't want to chase too far out so they can get around that lead skate when you slide out. You want to come out a little bit more square. Skate options. You've got skate on post. You've got pad in post. You've got pad lip on post, or your toe box on post, which has come up with a variety of different ways. And there's also another one which I'll share with you later on in the presentation. Okay, and then body options and recovery. So do you want to be straight up? Do you want to be curved over top of the puck? It depends on if you're close enough to have access to the puck and so forth. An example would be if the puck is below the goal line and Bishop's stick is like this and that puck hits here, where's the puck most likely going to go? It's going to go out into the slot. If the puck stopped here and moved away from him a bit, he would have to break the seal to grab that puck. And that's where the opportunities come into play. And all they need is just an inch of space to find that opening. So threats, high exposure areas. So for example, if you're far enough away, you can see the exposure areas of that net. You can see the passing across this area will all be exposure areas for sure. Oops. All right, you've got post seal opening. So anytime the puck goes from east to west, you're going to have to open your legs, which means you have to have some level of protection, whether it be from your stick, whether it be a paddle down, whether it be a blocker. and then blocker, chest openings, entrance made passes, and so forth, and rebounds. So we're going to move this ahead, and we're going to take a look at some options here.
Pasco.
Yeah.
I see Ben Bishop's his far skate. It's like a lot behind him.
Yeah.
Is that okay, or?
Well, we're probably catching. Anchored? The problem with pictures is we're probably catching Ben as he's moving into position. In fairness, Ben, he's also looks really off balance. His near side leg, it looks like it's coming off a little bit. And based on his lean, he's probably driving into the post. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, you want to have your skate out a little bit further for sure. And then if they attack to go from below to above, then you can use your little, like a little bit of a C-cut pattern or a hinge. Where you can seal the ice a little bit more, but you're seeing him in mid movement. That's why I've got the picture darkened out, but I wanted to show kind of the different receptions, the post receptions that you can receive. The other thing about having kind of a, an open berth, like having that elbow out in front, if you had to push into that, you can have a reception area between the elbow and the body as well as your pad. So it makes things a lot easier.
Hey, Pasco.
Yeah.
Before we get too much further ahead, can you elaborate a little more on those scouting reports you would do? Is it more so you were trying to expose, I guess, like a when and where situation, or is it more so you're trying to generate offenses and we're trying to create certain situations and get them to develop those, I guess, or expose those bad habits that you noticed on film?
Yeah. Yeah. Basically it's both. It would depend on what level it is. So if it's at a moderate level, say junior A, major junior, you're really trying to identify the weaknesses the goaltender has in their structure. So if they're not very good skaters, or if they have a really wide stance, or they tend to be set in a really wide stance, or they always use RVH skate on post, and they always have their stick like Carey Price here, regardless of where the puck is, kind of like Anderson of Ottawa, always has a stick this way, and that blue paint right beside the crease is always open for passes. So if you recognize those little trends, then those would be your high level overview, and then you would drill down into situations of how you can expose or force him or her to make those movements take place. And when followed, it's incredible. A couple of years ago, we really beat Finland pretty badly in the World Championship 6-1. We followed the process. Everybody really executed on the scouting report. They did a great job. And then what happens to teams sometimes is they tend to get really comfortable. Oh, we beat the team 6-1 and everything's fine. And then I can show something to you if I have it on my computer. I just wiped out my computer, but I'll see if I find it. And I'll show you the difference between when you follow a scouting report and when you don't follow a scouting report. And then it'll give you an idea of how you can expose goaltenders. In the National Hockey League level, it's all about what their tendencies are that week, because their goalies and the goalie coaches are so good at identifying what's happening with them. And we all forget, oh, this is what I would teach Carey. Well, you know what? These guys are going home to their wives. You know, they have lives. They have sick kids. They have all kinds of stuff that goes on, just like any other person that goes to a job. This is their job. So a lot, it doesn't matter what you train or what you teach these guys, because life sometimes gets in the way too. So those are things to take into consideration as you start to go through and think that we can, you know, somehow we all walk on water, but we got to remember it's frozen.
Thank you.
Do you have any theories on how you teach younger kids versus older kids? And does the situation differ based on their size?
You know, it's an excellent, excellent question. I think that what we need to do is understand the simplicity behind things. So have a goaltender stationary. First and foremost, the first phase of goaltending really is having a goalie stand there and execute saves. So they'll catch a puck, they'll use a blocker, then they can execute a butterfly. If they can do those things, then we want to introduce, or at the same time, we want to be introducing shuffles, T-pushes, pivots. You know, we want to introduce those four different skating tactics, right? You want to introduce a shuffle, you want to introduce a pivot, you want to introduce a T-push. You want to introduce those four different things and get them to move into a position and then execute those same saves. Body blocking, blocker, glove, stick. Okay. Once they've mastered that portion, those of you who are, you know, a little older, you'll recognize the butterfly and the half butterfly. Do you guys remember the half butterfly? Okay. The half butterfly really is a modified RVH. The only difference now is instead of just the edge of your foot sitting up, the whole pad is down and we're actually leaning towards the puck, which is a much, much bigger improvement. So when you get into the RVH, I'd be really, really careful in teaching the RVH. And one of the things that we'd recommend, especially in Hockey Canada, not to talk about the Americans, because the Americans are doing a great job at training their goalies too, is teach the RVH pad in post first if you're going to teach it. And I would wait. I wouldn't teach the RVH too early to a goaltender that still needs to master the four skating movements, still needs to get the butterfly catching, body blocking, and recoveries. Once they've gotten that done, then we can get into some more complex moves. And the main reason is because when you execute an RVH incorrectly, which means it'll all look good, it'll all look correct, but if you don't sit in the RVH correctly, you can put unbelievable hip impingement problems and create a huge problem for yourself. And there's goalies that I won't talk about that are pros that have had surgery on their hips because of overuse of the VH, or sorry, overuse of the RVH and or too many butterflies over a certain number of years. But definitely the RVH has drastically increased hip problems. So what I would do with them is I'd get them in a butterfly, and then I'd get them to track with their head, because tracking is a huge part of the body movement. It's how you marry the movement to the position. And once you lean, it frees one leg and you're able to push into the post, and teach them how to receive the post, pad and post, elbow around the outside of the post, paddle down, and just start with those things. And then once they've mastered that, then you can move up to a reception into the post blocker side with the blocker above the pad, you know, blocking that little hole because the person's further away, you know, little things like that, so that you're creating specific situations. But an RVH, which is you only get scored on about 2% of the time, you don't want to spend, you know, 60% of your year on RVH. Skate on post, which I'll explain, and toe box on post, they have specific needs, and I'll instead of spoiling the presentation, it'll come up a little later on. Make sense? And if you have any questions after, I'd be happy to answer or share anything with you. Great question. So talked about, right? We'll move it back just a little bit. I'm at the mercy of these controllers, but when you look at Pekka Rinne on this particular play, this might not work. Oh, here we go. So now I did it. Let's see what happens here. We have to restart it here real quick. Sorry about that. I'll get it re-up again. Let's see here. I'll do it like this. Can you guys see this screen?
It's pitch black.
Just big.
Okay. Let me just see if I can share it with you guys. Resuming the share. Can you guys see it now?
No.
Nope. Okay. Let's see if we can do it again. Sorry about that. Sometimes we're going to run into some of these challenges.
Two pieces of butter fried toast, whatever, bread.
I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into this. So we've seen all of these, and I'll just move this ahead, and I'll just show it to you in an actual presentation format. So let's talk about the glove positioning. This is the one I was talking about when we're facing a save. So in that scenario, you've got Pekka Rinne making that save. Can you guys see now?
No.
Oh, okay. No, sorry. I don't know what happened here. Let's see. Back to Zoom. Let's go to share. Let's go to this one. You guys see it now?
Yep.
Okay, perfect. Yes. All right, let's see if this thing can work. All right, so to save. I remember when I talked about the glove. The glove's in good position to block the puck, but now he doesn't have access to it. If he moves to go after that puck rather than just staying where he is to block, what happens is that puck is going to find a space. It's going to, it can come off underneath the glove. It can go off the post. It can go off the pad. It can go off the pants and go into the net. So in this scenario, they shot it and it went between the glove and the body and into the net. Now, the goals that I'm showing you here, these are overtime winning goals. And coaches, it drives the coaches absolutely crazy when you do that stuff. So you really have to make sure that you're using your situation. So in that scenario, it would have been great for him because he was really in tight here. We'll go back. It would have been, they tried to go up, that triangular position that he would create by having his elbow outside the post, the puck would have hit the back of his arm and he would have been over top of it and would able to cover that puck. Okay. Hindsight's always 20/20, you know, when things aren't happening in milliseconds, but we get a chance to learn from these superstars every day. We're talking about RVH. The first thing I want you guys to notice is that you can see that Jonathan Quick up here at the top on the left side, he's got pad in post. You've got Braden Holpe down below, who's got skate on post. And then you've got another goaltender down here who's got his pad in post. You guys see that? So they're all different scenarios, and none of them are wrong, especially when the puck bounces away from your body. But I always ask myself the question, can I stop the puck 100% of the time? And more importantly, do I have a 92% chance of controlling the rebound? And the reason why I use 92% is because I want to make sure, like, no one's going to look at me as a goalie. No one's going to look at you as a goalie, a male goalie, unless you got a 92 save percentage. There's something magical at 92 where scouts really start paying attention. For women, it's usually 94, 95, more so than 95 percentage. So the one thing that you do see here is you see Jonathan Quick going in for a little bit of a poke check in that scenario with his shoulders completely lateral, almost moving into the net. And Braden Holpe's not square either. So what players are doing in these scenarios is they're looking, when they come from behind the net, they're looking to see what your post seal is going to be. So they're watching your extended foot move towards the post, and they're going, if that skate blade hits the post, I'm going to jam that foot and push it into the net, or I'm going to shoot it off your cowling. If it's your pad that's going to be going, that's going to seal the post, meaning your pad lip or your toe box goes in and seals the post and locks me out, I can use that pad as a rebound to the center of the ice in the slot, or I can move away, further away, so that I can move you left or right inside that area. So those things become really important. So same idea when we start moving through those processes, you can move your stick, you can move your blocker and position yourself. Here's another overtime winner. This is courtesy of Ed, Eddie Guay. Junior A. So you're talking about overtime. You're talking about a goaltender that's facing a puck from a zone one angle, a really bad, bad angle. And because we're not square to the puck, because we go into an RVH and we use skate on post, what happens is, boom. So when you start talking about things like that, coaches, it really drives the scouts crazy and the coaches crazy when we're allowing goals like that in. And those are overtime winning goals. Here's another one here. This is in the World Championship. So we're talking about shoulder squareness now. So watch the goaltender's squareness to this puck. Give me a little button hook here. So when you go down, we'll just move this ahead here. So when you see the player come up, he turns back around, little pass, goaltender enters an RVH, and then that backside foot, see that backside foot? It starts to leak back, and then the shoulders turn, and the whole net space is open upstairs. So these are really important elements. If he would have used more of a projected angle, and if he would have had his foot angled the appropriate way and his shoulders over top of the puck, we would have been in a much better situation here than getting beaten by plays like that. Does this help everybody? Seeing this slow down explained?
Yeah.
Yeah. Pasco. Okay.
Yep.
Like the Pecorine example, when the player's really up close, would that be the time to like put your elbow outside a post? Was that, yeah. Would that give you?
Yeah, that would be a great opportunity for you to go when he's coming from below the goal line up, or he's coming right at you in tight and you've got pressure from a D-man forcing him into that little area directly toward you. Absolutely. Yeah. Because you're in a block position now, but you want that hand outside the post so that as soon as it hits you, you can put your hand over it and freeze the puck.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. You don't want to have your hand pinched inside the post so that when they go and you go after it, now you've broken the seal and you've left probably, you know, this much of a gap, which you guys can't really tell from that distance, but it's about a 5 or 6 inch gap, which is much bigger than the puck. So we want to make sure that we hold the seal and then we are able to get down on top of that puck and still maintain that seal as we go through. Here's another one here. Making the first move. By making the first move, we tell them what to do. So there's an RVH off the head. You guys see that? So he goes into an RVH. He doesn't have full control over the RVH. He C cuts back or hinges back and he doesn't have that proper anchor foot. And then it gets you upstairs. Here's another one. So this is another one when you make the first move. So watch how early the goalie is here. Do you guys see that? So it's way north of the goal line, way at the edge of zone one. I'll move this over again. So I'll pause it. So here he goes. He's in zone one because, when he reaches this hash mark right there, the hash mark that's on top of the, you know, if you're taking a look at the boards, that you see the two hash marks, the one on the one that's closest to the blue line, that puck is inside that zone now. That area towards the net, I don't know why it does that every time. So this area right here, the line will go right through to here. Do you guys see that? That is zone one. That goaltender should really be at the edge of his, closer to the edge of his crease into what? What would be a better choice for this goalie?
Overlap.
Overlap.
Anybody else?
Overlap for sure.
Absolutely. There's no backside pressure. Even the rebound, I mean, the toughest part, this guy may get an opportunity for a rebound, but he's surrounded by five Latvian players. So it's like why he's going into an RVH north of the goal line in zone one where it could be simple, a simple butterfly save is costing goals. And these things are so important. And it all starts with a scan. So let's watch this. I'll turn this down so that we don't get bugged by it. But, you know, this is a bad goal. And these are things where it's like, well, I didn't have a chance. Well, it's because you put yourself in a position that rapidly decreased your ability to A, stop the puck, and B, you had no chance of a rebound anyway because you're letting the puck in the net. So again, it violates my personal rule of 100% save, 92% save percentage or rebound control. So let's move this ahead a little bit so we get a chance to see it at a different aspect. So here's the goaltender here. RVH, the shot's not taken yet. And in the net it goes. So when you look at that and you look at when the goaltender's about to shoot, that player, when he has that puck and he's just about to shoot now, he can change it. He can change the angle of that shot when he sees you dropping. Like right now, if you look, that goaltender's starting to drop. This player now sets up a shot. You see that? And then you're down, he shoots up. And that's how the game is played. So he comes down into zone one. Look at the hole on that side. Now, that hole bugs me because we lost a gold medal because of an RVH play on Hillary Knight on the women's national program scored on us when we used this type of tactic. And there's no need to go into an RVH when the puck is north of the goal line, especially when it's inside the circle. We got to be very, very careful. Shooters nowadays are very, very good. Their weapon, their stick is absolutely phenomenal. It even makes a goalie coach like me have a great shot. So it's pretty phenomenal. Like you can really, really have a really good way to look at it. So one of these things here, these are all videos that we had, I was tired of seeing an RVH goal every single night in the National Hockey League. And taking a look at this process here, you'll see the puck came from behind. You knew it was going to happen based on the look. So take a look right now. Who's getting the puck? I mean, the physiology of the player behind the goal line, you know this guy's getting the puck on the other side. He goes from below the goal line to above the goal line. Now we're in an RVH. And look at the angle of the shoulders. The elbow's inside the post. The far side anchor pad is way back. So what happens? Boom, it goes in the net. So we'll watch it again here from a different angle. I show it and zoom in and all kinds of stuff here. You can see as he goes down, the guy's going to make that decision. Yes, it's a great shot. But it's a goal that every goaltender would have loved to have had back. Nobody would have said, hey, this is a great goal. I never had a chance. Look at the movement here. He's already down. He knows he's going up. And that's a great shot. I mean, these guys are the best in the world at what they do. And, you know, if you're going to sit down like that, they're going to find a hole. Okay, I encourage you, if you guys have homework, just go and take a look at Alex Ovechkin shooting Russian dolls. He misses one. Like, he's pretty amazing. Watch Crosby backhand. Okay, so you'll see the same thing again coming down. Now, Mike. Oh. Let's go over here. Smith. Okay, so it's just me yicking and yakking. So as they come down again, shooting upstairs, creating that huge space. And what I usually use when I'm talking to goalies and goalie coaches that I work with is that we have to move away from the post to get into it. You guys see how Smith is in position. He's a huge goalie. And then look at the space that we create down there, that awkward triangular space that we create. Even though this one goes above him, which, I mean, he's so big, I have no idea how he stood there. Here's Markstrom. This is another really, really good one. So I did this one really slow. So Markstrom's on the post. This is from 2 years ago. I'm going to move this ahead a little bit more, a little faster. Okay, so from this angle, you can see Markstrom actually going down. There he is. He's down already on north of the goal line shot. So you know that goalie coaches, you know, in essence, are using timing mechanisms with their goaltenders and saying this could work. And what happens is that when these guys start seeing, when they have a really, really good goalie coach, like David Alexander was one of the biggest reasons why St. Louis won the Stanley Cup this year, because he shared goaltending tendencies and how to score on goaltenders. But when you look at these, what better to understand that if you're going to go down first, look at the hole down just above the pad too. Even though it went up here, there's little holes everywhere that they can expose, and they will expose them. So here's that other one. He's down, he's leaning backwards and away. And then upstairs the puck goes. Very easy to tear these guys apart. Again, because it's half cost a goal. Yeah.
Pasco, do you have any different strategies for backhand forehand?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the last part.
Do you treat it any differently if it's a backhand attack or a forehand attack?
Well, yeah, you can get into that as you start to move a little higher up the ladder. But if your stick is outside of the slot versus inside of the slot. For older guys, it's like, okay, if he's coming down the right side, if he's right-handed, the puck's going to have to come most of the time across his body to get to the net. So yes, you could play it differently, but again, that's a zone one attack. And if you remember what I talked about in zone one in the past, zone one is no wider than a goaltender. And if you stay square, that puck is going to hit you in the chest, or it's going to hit you in the belly, or it's going to hit you in the pads. Your biggest worry is that thing going to end up being put into the slot, which will increase the scoring opportunity from zone one to zone three, if that makes sense. So yeah, you could play it differently. But in essence, in zone one, it's a pretty predictable situation, meaning that if you start rotating your shoulders like all these goalies are doing, or they're entering RVHs and doing things before the shot's even taken, they're not block saves. The RVH is a block style save, can be reactionary on rebound control. But if you start doing things above and beyond that, you're going to find yourself in big trouble. But yeah, lefts and rights. So like, this is a left-handed player here. So, I mean, there's a lot of options in here. He can hit the far side. He can hit, the pass becomes much easier, things like that. God, I don't know why it keeps doing that. Let's try this again.
Hey, Pasco, I had a question for you.
Yeah.
As far as like the structuring goes in the RVH stuff, you're mentioning a lot of big guys like Rene and Smith and whatnot. I was just wondering if the whole foundation that you're laying out, if that change is based on, you know, having a lot of bigger guys.
Yes and no. And I'll try to answer a little bit better than that. Big goaltenders are fantastic. Obviously they cover a lot of net space. The challenge with big goaltenders is getting up. That's why you'll see goaltenders like Ben Bishop or Scott Darling or Pekka Rinne, they'll stay down in their RVH longer as the puck starts to make its way from the corner up the boards. And they'll look for that 50-50 engagement before they recover a lot of the times, because all of their space opens up on the ice to their knees. Whereas a smaller goaltender covers a lot of that net space. Like, not that Jonathan Quick is a small goalie, but he plays kind of that explosive, smaller style goaltender that he's able to get in, and his skating is so incredible that he's able to get up a lot earlier than a lot of the other goaltenders could. The messaging from the brain to the legs is a lot quicker as well. You know, the challenge with Jonathan Quick is that, you know, can he sustain that type of play for long periods of time, because he's so acrobatic and so, you know, a lot of injury can be sustained over something like that. So with big goalies at RVH, it still has to work as far as the timing is concerned. You have to know, I always say positioning, timing, reward. If you have really good positioning and you have your timing down, then you'll be rewarded with the save. You can't get something earlier than that. So there's advantages and disadvantages to big goalies and small goalies using an RVH. But if you're looking back at that diagram I showed you guys, if you're executing an RVH outside of action reaction, which means it's in control or the puck is above, say, zone one, you're using a tactic that may be a correct skill, but an incorrect situation for the skill, if that makes sense. Like you could make a blocker save, but you're trying to use your glove, or you can make a stick save and you're using your glove. Like, it's not wrong, but it's not the most effective way to play the game.
Hey, Pasco.
Yeah.
All right. Have you been able to watch a lot of, so we're talking about big versus small. I think the perfect compliment would be for someone like Pekka, who's like, I think he's like, what, 6'4", 6'5"?
Yeah.
Versus his counterpart, UC Saros. Do you think that's something, again, like, I think UC's like, what, is he 5'10"? And someone, I guess, like that trend of quote-unquote tall goalies, do you think that's starting to decline just with someone who has, I guess, quote-unquote elite skating ability, or someone that's just as smart?
Yeah, I think that when you're – yeah, I've heard, and there's lots of articles showing and stating that there's nobody under 6'2 or 6'3 is going to be drafted into the National Hockey League moving from here on in. That might be at the general manager coach level from the old school per se, but the goaltending coach is no different. A lot of coach is no different as well. Like the smaller goaltenders, 5'10", 5'11", 6 feet, those goaltenders are extremely effective, extremely effective. Like Pekka Rinne was in the Stanley Cup final a few years ago, and did they win? No. Did he allow a lot of goals, especially in the RVH? Yes, he did. You know, you look at a lot of different goaltenders that are out there, and it really comes down to timing as well. If the big goalie goes down too early, the pass takes place and their ability to move becomes inhibited, unless you're a very, very kind of a weird goaltender, meaning that if you're like Kari Lehtinen, or you were like, let me just kind of think through my... Like, if you saw Robin Lehner move, he wasn't moving as smoothly. But in the last few years, he's moved really, really, really smoothly because there's been a lot of emphasis on training through his skating and things like that. If you have the ability to move very quickly, you can. If you're a smaller goaltender, you have to be more patient. You have to hold your edges longer, and then you have to execute when you have to execute. There's a little bit of a margin of error. Size just gives you a little bit more of an opportunity to maybe catch the puck, you know, off your body, off your elbow, off whatever, because of sheer size. But it doesn't mean that you're going to be more effective than a smaller goalie. I mean, look at some of the goalies in the past from, you know, Andy Moog and you know, all these different guys that have played in the past, some pretty good goaltenders. So I still think that that's, The one thing that general managers need to understand too is the fact that the top of the net is only 37 inches high anyway at the crease. So if they're really good at understanding box control, if they're really good at understanding puck trajectory, if they're really good at the basic skills of getting to the puck into the situation faster than the player is going to shoot the puck, which means you're waiting for the shot release, you're going to be way on top of the game. And the people that have the best opportunity are guys that have complete control. Jake Allen, he's another weird goaltender. What I mean by that is he's like a 5'7 goalie at 6 feet. He just moves so beautifully, and he's a big guy, and he can, you know, Dave Alexander did a great job with him in getting him developed. The biggest thing is that if you can move really smoothly, really quickly and effectively, you're going to be able to get away with a lot more than most people can. But I see the trend of big goalies. I see it starting to change, but it'll be easier for us to see it than the GMs. It'll take a little bit longer for the old school guys to kind of accept it. Bigger is not always better when it comes to goaltending. It's how well you can move and how well you can think the game. Best goalie in the world is not 6'7". You know, Marty Brodeur still holds a lot of records, does he? From my opinion, he's a pretty good goalie.
Hey, quick question on the second last point you made with, taller guys maybe sinking in the RVH, kind of sitting a little bit longer. So you're saying it might be a little bit more advantageous to just kind of like hold your positioning on your knees just a split second longer to allow yourself an opportunity to get up without opening up opportunity?
I mean, staying on your knees as far as opening up, I'm talking about timing mechanisms. So for example, if a player is coming around this way and as you're looking at him coming around the other side here, you guys see my mouse?
Yeah.
Is having the ability to recognize right at this point that he's turning up towards the net. That's the part where you're sliding into that post to shut him down. You have the stick that's out here. You have your hand that's down here because you want to be as close to that as you can. If you see that he's taking a further plane, which means maybe he faked, but then went further away in the hopes of catching you from a little bit of a wider stance, then you got to read that. And you have the ability to see that he's coming out a little bit wider, so you have the ability to stand in good position. Sorry, it keeps getting me. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So here you could see, like, Markstrom, when he goes down, you could see that this right here, he's leaning, like he's sitting on his calf muscle. You guys see that? So that's not really the best position to be in, and that's one of the most dangerous for hip impingements. What he's done there is the same thing that other goaltenders have done as well in the Vancouver system in the past that have caused some hip impingement problems. And you got to sit up a little higher, because what he's done is he's taken a ball and socket joint, which is basically sitting inside of, having the ability to move in a variety of different ways, and he's turned it into a hinge joint. So think about this. Your shoulders are like your hips. Your elbows are like your knees. Your wrists are like your ankles. Does that make sense? You guys get that? Like, your shoulders are like your hips. You can move them around and you can, in circular motion. The elbows are like your knees. They only move in one direction, right? They open and close. And then you've got your wrists, which are just like your ankles. They move in a lot of different ways. So it's really important for us to respect the fact that you don't want to turn something that's so mobile and so ability to move and force it to do an action that it's not really meant to do. And that's what's causing a lot of the, pounding of the bone against bone inside the hip joint. So you want to be very, very careful as you're going through these types of situations. Sit up a little bit higher over top of that pad and closing down that net space. By being in good position. This is a failed VH here. So carrying on. Okay, so Sidney Crosby again. Very good scan. So I don't know if you saw that with with Gibson's a very smart goalie. So he'll see him there on his backhand. So that's the time to scan. Now he's got the shooting position. He can't worry about anything except the shot now. And then his hand is not quite projected. It's actually pinned inside the post. Do you guys see that? So now with his hand pinned inside the post, Crosby will see that is left here. But Crosby will sell that flat blade and then at the last minute toe it, and it'll go right up into here. You'll see it. Someone with that level of there's Crosby again. Backhand up over top. I call that one decision. You got to use your projected angle. So Here's the NCAA. Great move by this player through the legs. And what does the player drop into? RVH, and the hand is low. Puck goes upstairs. Really important for everybody to recognize the fact that when we use things that are at the improper time and your timing is off, you're going to pay a price. So here's that play. Moves into a forehand, drops into an RVH, goes to his forehand there. No disruption of the trajectory, which means there's no projected angle. He's not going at the puck with his hand. And then I'll show you one more here, which is the thanks to Eddie Guay. You'll see it here. Well, here. So this is the BC Hockey League. This is an RVH failed. So that's at the hash marks, and now just below the circle, goalie drops into an RVH and it's in the net. We'll see it from another angle, and you'll see how awkward the skate, as you see the goalie's almost falling over. But watch, he moves over, drops into an RVH, and in the net it goes. Okay, so another big, big guy. This guy's probably over 6'1", 6'2", and allows a goal like that. Just unacceptable.
Hey, Pasco.
Yeah.
What's the dialogue? So, like, if you can go back to that one or even that UConn goal, what's the dialogue for you like with your goaltender on that? And it sounds like an odd question, but it's just, how are you approaching, like, again, like, every goalie coach is supposed to have a game plan with their goalies, especially, I guess, like, I envision that game map that you kind of have where you guys, you know, obviously you have a plan and they're just not executing. So, like, on a goal like this where it's like, it doesn't even look like he has the opportunity to get a clean seal because he waited too long. What's, I guess, how are you approaching that with him?
Well, I'm taking, like, in this situation, this isn't a goalie that I've worked with, but it's great video for it. how I look at it is very simple. The goaltender or the player right now is in the control. This is obviously a power play, but there's a player that's in the control section of the ice. He's outside the most threatening area. So my biggest concern is if I'm that goaltender is I'm scanning for the next most dangerous player. So there's a guy right there that I'm worried about. I'm not really worried about this guy. That's a huge, long shot. So as that player comes over and he starts going down below the goal line, this to me is going to be a VH no-brainer because you've got backside pressure. You've already got someone banging into the net here. You've got a guy that's right here, and I've got two players, potentially three players that can disrupt this guy. So instead of using a VH in that scenario, the goaltender drops down. There's no reason to drop down from that distance. That's 5 feet at least, maybe, yeah. Well, in that building, maybe even 10 because it's an Olympic-sized rink, but that's way outside of the action-reaction section of the ice. Not that the name matters, but there's really no reason for us to go down in that scenario. So I'd be using timing. And whenever I break things down, I go back to that diagram and I go from below to above. I go from above to below. I go from above, staying above in the dead angle, cutting across. I work through all the different scenarios to make sure the goaltender has a plan for each one of those. And then I talk about recognizing through tendencies, what is the player going to do? Try to recognize early based on toe caps or his vision or his body's physiology. Like, what is the play going to look like? Does the player look like he's going to go below the goal line and go around the net? I spend more time teaching the physiology aspect once we've got the skills and the patience down. So again, positioning and timing down. Then we talk about the rewards. How do we identify what this threat is going to look like? So even if we look at this and we're looking at potential threats on this goaltender, this guy's being pretty good. This guy's doing great in boxing him out. There's one guy that's available. You can see he's worried already because this guy's coming into play. The goalie's just got the shooter to look at. So there's no reason to RVH here. He doesn't even have an RVH. He's skidded outside of the net. So that's really where I spend my time in working with the goaltender. Does that help?
That's cool.
Yeah.
Sorry, quick question. Could you go back to that just last clip there?
Sure.
Just at the end from the behind the net. Like, is his position and his stance put him in a, like he gets so wide here?
Yeah.
That, like, I don't think he can get into a VH, do you?
Well, that's the question, right? You know, that's a great question. One of the questions I would ask the guy is, why are you in a stance that's so wide? the biggest thing is if you're in that wide stance, you're going to have problems moving left to right anyway. And even if you had to center shift in the zone, it would be very difficult to do that. You could, but it'd be difficult to do that and still have the height that you needed. So the question is like, was his stance in the right spot? Did he move into a position? Looked like he had an overlap plan, which he would have been better choosing a VH, but he had an overlap plan. But because he's in that scenario and his legs are so wide, he can't move as effectively. So those would be questions as to, okay, what was your strategy here? Like, I wouldn't say this is what you're doing wrong. I'd say, what's your strategy here? What was your goal? Is there a reason why you chose a wide stance in a very narrow entrance way? You know, did you see something that I didn't see, you know, in that scenario? So getting to know why they made the decisions that they made are really important. But yeah, I mean, you're 100% correct. I mean, that's a whole lane that's coming towards the net. Like, why are you in those positions? If that puck is stopped and it ends up somewhere in here, this goalie can't get there. He's going to drop down and he's going to scatter and slide everywhere to try to stop the puck. Mm-hmm. Did you have something to add to that at all, Gord?
No, I just, that was just something that I sort of like thought, like just his positioning, he really limits what he's able to do there. And it like looked almost like he's sitting on his heels a little bit.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So I just thought he really, the only option he kind of really had there was either, like you said, overlap or that RVH.
I would even beg to argue the fact that when you watch him get scored on, watch him get up, that he's got stock skates on right now as far as stock blades. They're not even, watch. So he's not even, like, I don't think that he's even in a situation where he can have proper balance. Hey, John, how you doing? Where he has proper balance. So what I recommend a lot of goaltenders to get, and they'll always get the eyebrows raised when they walk into a sports shop, but if a goalie has a balance problem like that, I'd probably get him to do a 13-degree radius with a 1-degree pitch forward. That's kind of the standard. And when you have a 13-1, you have the ability to be a little bit more on your toes, which is where you want to be. And you have, it's almost like being in a running shoe. If you and I were to play basketball, Gord, you would kick my ass. But if we're playing, we're on the balls of our feet trying to move and change direction a lot. This goaltender's balancing more on the fascia of his feet, so between the balls of his feet and the heels of his feet. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yep, absolutely. Thank you.
Right. No worries. So going into this, this is all video from Network Goaltending. So in this scenario, all the goaltenders are doing are just there's an iPad that's right in front of them, so they have an opportunity to see what they have as far as holes are concerned. So the netting on the back is off, so they can see what it looks like. And they're just trying to get into the posts and experiment to get into position. Now, a couple of things to take into consideration here, like in this last one. One of the most important things about the reverse VH is the head. And if your head is over top of the puck and it's able to move back and forth, and if you want to see a guy that's pretty phenomenal at it, Jonathan Quick is one of those guys. But if your head is over top of the puck, you're going to be able to, for example, if Ben was to move his head to the right, right? If Ben was to move his head to the right, what happens to the right leg? What are you guys noticing? So if the puck was to go from his glove side to his blocker side in front of him, okay, say the guy's deking and he comes out in front to go east-west, when he brings his head over, what happens to the pad?
Drops the leg and pulls the
shot. Weight.
Yeah, it drops to the ice, and all that is a weight transfer. There's really no push required. You know, maybe even a very, very small push, but if you look at where his head is, it's actually going up. See that? And really what we should be doing is we should be focusing on bringing the head through here, if that makes sense. Does that make sense to you guys? So it's about bringing your head and allowing your body to work in a position where you're going to get the most out of it. And that's what happens when you're talking about RVH, where the first things that go wrong, like look at what we're looking at with the stick right now. And this is just practice, but you know, do we have control over the stick, and would we drag the stick behind? Would we position it in that position as we're going through? In fairness to the goaltender, he's working on you know, receiving the post and things like that. But I believe that you got to pay attention to a lot of the things that are really important to receiving posts. So right now, if you bring your head, and we talk about bringing the head through the elbow, so bringing your head through here and looking where that puck is going to be the biggest threat, which is down here, you want to bring that head over rather than pushing from underneath it. Okay, you have a choice to push from underneath it, or you have a choice to push from the outside. So if you think about a runner leans forward, gets down in a position, and then the gun goes off, and then they explode moving forward. The same scenario happens for a goaltender, except from a lateral position. So when you look, lean, you're able to load the foot, and it drives you to the post in a lot more of a seamless position. That was actually not too bad. You guys see that? So it's about bringing that head close. I have another video of Andrew Hammond doing it, and his was like he's almost going over top of the mountain when he executes it. So Andrew's in this next one here, you'll see it. But going into the post, paddle down. Some guys like to lead with their paddle down first, and that's going to open up space above the shoulder and force goaltenders or force players to move around you. So watch, if you're a player that's behind the net here, the first thing you're going to do when you're coming this way is you're going to look at this foot. And that's what the skills coaches are teaching the guys. Okay, you're also going to look at this hand, but mainly this foot. So as that foot comes into the post, that's pad and post. So now in that scenario, the biggest thing is you're not going to be able to get him here because he's going to have a post seal with his blocker and a stick, and he's also going to have a toe seal. So that's jammed in. So his biggest weakness here is going to be moving further, if the space is there, further out, and then shoot for that open space, or shoot for that top space if he can get further away, right? If he uses skate on post, then let's see if we can get him in a skate on post here. He might be just using skate. Let's, maybe Andrew will do it. So there's toe box on post. You see that? So toe box is another way and a more advanced way of kind of sealing that post and locking. Think about it as an eagle grabbing a branch or a bird grabbing a branch. You're wanting to grab that and stay nice and tight and strong and lock in and maximize your seal on your post. If your pad is in the post, you could find yourself in a little bit of trouble as you get up to the higher levels. If your pad is too deep into the post or you're not able to bounce off the post to the center, but I'm a big fan of pad and post in a lot of scenarios. I find toe box on post very, very good too, but it's tough. You have to really practice toe box. And the one thing here with Andrew in his scenario is that the biggest piece of advice to get back into it would be his head. The head is going to turn the shoulders, is going to turn the hips, is going to allow him to receive the post a lot better than allowing the head to hover a little bit too high, if that makes sense. Okay. When you're talking about a position of bumping, so this is an overhead view. So when you're in the middle of the ice and you're making a save and the puck goes to the right, then you have the ability to bump out. So maybe that puck didn't go below the goal line or into the dead angle, but it bounced off and into a much more playable scenario. You know, this goaltender, Jimmy, was able to bounce off that post and get into gain more depth. So you can see how you can angle it. And the biggest thing that you want to look at in this scenario here is just watch how he receives the post. As he receives the post, he then points his toe. See that? And that's what gives him, it's just a small little adjustment. You guys see that? And from that scenario, he could actually step up into a stance position if he needed to. But it's just a very small little movement. And you'll watch him point his toe and look at how much depth he's gained. And he's barely moved. So knowing what is it, when do you use it, and why does it work is one of the key principles that I like to focus on, is like, what are you doing? Why are you doing it? Why does it make sense? And then that's where you can get into different dialogue. Now, I'm giving you some great places to start from, but you know, you might meet a goaltender, which I've met in the past, but you know, maybe they've got some challenges. They got an ankle problem, a knee problem, a hip problem, and then you have to find different ways. This is just the front view. You have to find different ways to be able to execute this. So it's the same with Jimmy here, where he's looking from left to right. And if he was to look, where's the puck going to be here, guys? where's the puck going to be here? He's playing a game as if he's, as if the player's coming around this way. Would we, can we agree on that? So where is his biggest, where's his biggest problem going to be?
Bottom circle.
What's that? His biggest bottom problem circle. Is, yeah, his problem, his biggest problem is going to be down in here, right? So that's the biggest threat, is if this guy comes around and tucks it right in here. That's why they've shaved off the edges of these posts. So the thing you got to be, that's where your head really needs to go. If that player goes further away, you're fine. But the biggest threat is down low. And that's one of the challenges. That's why we have like kind of a little bit of a cockeyed movement here from the goaltender. But look at how much depth Jimmy's able to go with. He's not the biggest guy either. But as you come across, you got a little bit of a bump there. And that's what the bump looks like. So you guys can experiment. And you can bump out. You can also bump in. So as you back in, you have the ability to have some backwards flow. And then you can use that bump off the post to get to a net center position. This is another one. Watch this method of RVH. So do you guys see the difference there? So he's outside of the post and they're using, he's using his skate on the outside of the post. Very dangerous. But at the same time, he was able to get into a position where he's able to seal the post and kind of get into somewhat of an RVH to be in that block style position. Lots of battles here. So there's Braden Holpe using a similar tactic there, getting his foot to the outside of the post, which helps. Because sometimes what they do is they come around and as you slide it by, they come in and tuck it in on you. Okay. So just getting back to the basics here again, these are all different scenarios, elbow in post, elbow outside of post, your hand is closed and on top of your pad, or it could be open. You can use skate on post. You can use toe box, pad and post. You can be in a high stance. You can be in a more of a puck and head trajectory type of position. You get into threats. You recognize that the high exposure areas, your post seal openings, your blocker chest openings, east-west carries, pass and rebounds. So those scenarios are very important to understand that, you know, what is it? What's the situation you're facing? What type of tactic or technique do you want to protect yourself in? What is going to be the best? Oops, sorry, let me just try to get in here for. Like, what's the best scenario for you to put yourself into and go from there? Because the more focused you are on getting the right things done, the better you're going to be. And knowing what the situation is, practicing those situations, and recognizing that there's a lot of different scenarios. When we say RVH, which we still do in Canada and the US, RVH is not just one thing. There's many, many things. And there's 16 different ways to execute an RVH. And it's growing by the day. And some things are kind of disappearing a little bit because they're not as effective. So we have to continue to grow with the game. So hopefully, based on last week's conversation and this week's kind of lesson on RVH, I was able to, show and shine a little bit of a light on the reverse VH. Just want to open it up for questions for anybody. If you have any questions, or was that okay?
Pasco, I've got one. It's Rod Wisco here.
Hey, Rod, how you doing?
I'm well. Thank you very much for having me.
Oh, no worries.
You mentioned 16 variations of the RVH. I'm just sort of thinking, I guess it's kind of like you're talking about the post, the skate integration, how your arms are located in the shoe glove positioning as well.
Absolutely.
And if I flesh that out, it comes to 16, because I've never actually heard that number or even discussed that. That's very interesting to me. Is there somewhere where maybe a group of us can get together and just talk about the 16 variations? Because that's pretty cool.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. We could certainly set up a time to do something like that and go over them. And I because this is kind of a bit of a request, and what I'd like to do is see if we can get some of that information rather than searching for it all and then putting together a presentation. It'd be easier for me in 10 minutes to go on the ice, put some of those photographs together and then bring them in. For sure. And the key is, especially with a goaltender coach, the key is like taking that body and going, okay, what's going to work for this athlete in this particular time situation. Frame? Yeah, yeah, like yeah, is, yeah. Is the person an athlete, or are they just wearing the pads right now and becoming an athlete? Right. Are they a pro and they're having certain issues or challenges moving in and out of those things? Those play a massive, massive role.
Yeah, no, that's a very cool idea. That's something to use the time on during the quarantine.
Yeah, and the big thing too is just to recognize, okay, what is it? Okay, if it's your elbow around the post on your glove side and your hand open wide,
yeah,
when would be the best position to use that? And the reason why I have the hand open wide is because the reception of the puck on the outside would hit the outside of the glove, drop down, and then all you do is you just, well, I don't know if you can see me or not. See if
yeah, I can find myself.
Okay. So when you're in position, once that puck is shot or it just lifted up to try to score on you, it hits the back of your glove, then you can chase that puck back down again with your glove on, with your elbow and your glove on the outside, you're able to come back down and cover it. If your elbow's inside the post, then you're coming out of that post to go after it. And that's where you're opening up things. So it's identifying what you want to use in certain situations.
And then one variable too, you talked about how the Swedes are upright like this with their head against the post, right?
Right.
So, and everybody else in the world is sort of hinged at the hips. Is that variation even, should that even be included in the 16? Right.
Yeah, I don't sit on the Supreme Court of goaltending and to say this is not going to work. No, this is going to work.
We're just talking, right? Because you said I'm stuck on the 16. Like maybe there's less or more, but I think it's pretty cool to explore.
I would venture to guess that there's more because there's a lot of creative goalie coaches out there. The biggest thing is that what's going to work best for that goalie? Like are we just going to go? I remember in the past it was skate on post and that's it.
Yeah.
And that's all the guys would teach. And that's what I like better. That's what I'm going to teach. But in reality, if you have skate on post, it also adds a significant amount of space between the body and the post. So are you flexible enough to be able to cover that space and lean? If you do lean, are you putting more pressure on your knee and your hip? Number three, are you able to get out of it? So it's not just as much to get into it. How do you get out of it? And I don't see a lot of people teaching goalies how to get out of it. And, we're spending so much time on RVH. The challenge is that I think the goalies, by the time they're 16 or 17, especially women, they have damaged hips by the time they get there. I've had two spectacular female goaltenders that played in the NWHL, but they've been, for so many years, they've been pounding their legs, and they had to, like at 17, they have to know where they're going. So they go to the NCAA at 18. So now they've gone from, probably an academy to full-time NHL style, 5 days a week plus school and everything else, pounding their bodies. By the time they're 21, 22 years old, their hips are so shot from constant practice on that. So the key is to make sure you're taking care of your enterprise or your business because no one's going to play the game for you. Right?
Yeah.
But yeah. Pasco,
Pasco, to that point, when I was looking at that shot you had of Andrew Hammond from behind, I know one of the things that you talk about quite a bit is the amount of padding in the knee stack and making sure the knee is at the right height in relation to the ankle. And then just as you're talking about getting out of the position, just making sure that your equipment's in the right place to be able to give you the best advantage for that.
Right. That's so true, Brad. It's a great question. Great to hear from you, Brad. I can't see you except your name. So the goaltenders are on here, a goaltending coach. I'm not sure how many people are left on here, but the key is to recognize that we have moving people. Hey, buddy, we have growing bodies. So young goalies that are playing, they're growing. So if you buy a set of pads, it's really important to see them in a butterfly and then go in behind them and see, is their knee closer to the ice than their ankles? And if it is, they don't need more goalie lessons to try to fix a recovery. They need their pads to be shimmed a little bit to give them an opportunity to be able to get up easier. Does that make sense? Right? So if you think about if everybody here was to put their leg on their desk or wherever they are right now, and they put their leg on their desk, go ahead and stand up. Because you got to feel it. Put your leg on the desk and just raise your ankle up. Where do you feel the pressure? Like even sitting in your chair, take your heel and try to lift it up above to where your hip is. Where do you feel all that pressure? So you feel a lot in your hip. area. So it's really important for you to make sure that you're allowing your knees to be a little bit higher than your ankles, not too much, because it can be counter-effective or counterproductive, because your pads will come up off the ice and pucks will slide underneath. But you want just a little bit of a raise in there, and that way you're able to get up a lot faster and a lot more smooth. Anybody else? I think there's only five of us left. Maybe five, maybe more. Oh no, there's a lot.
No, there's 31.
31, okay. Does that make sense? I know it makes sense to Brad. I think he was making a point, so.
Yeah, thank anybody you, else? That's great.
Yeah, so I would really take the time to practice. If you're gonna practice an RVH, go from a butterfly and slide to the post. Not so much sliding to the boards, but go to a butterfly, slide to the post, and recognize the fact that there's a triangle. You guys see this net behind me here. If I was to draw a triangle right here, from the post to the middle of my crease to the post, that's about where you want to be from. You're making a butterfly, slide to the post, and then use your head to come back to the middle. Do a butterfly, slide to the post, use your head, come back to the middle. And that way you're able to focus your attention a little bit more appropriately. You wouldn't make a save up in here in the white area of your crease and then try to RVH over here. Okay. You could have that, hit it, and then angle back. But most of the time you're going to make your butterfly save. You're going to power slide to a position where you can be there and then get back to your post and execute, more so than RVHing and being down, sliding all over the place. Brendan, your hair looks spectacular today. I don't think Brendan can hear me. There you can. All right.
Yeah, thanks. I'm going for the Aaron Oakley flow.
Perfect. Perfect. Anybody else? Any questions? All right. Hopefully this helped out. Send me your feedback through Instagram or through an email at pascovalana@elitegoalies.com or through Twitter on a direct message. And we'll hold another one next weekend at 11 o'clock, and I'll wait for some ideas of what you want to hear about, whether it's, you know, certain situations, certain skills, or reading the play, and then I'll develop a presentation for you guys for next week. All right? Sounds Take good. Care, guys. Have a good one.
Thank you, buddy. Pasco.
Take care, thanks, Dave. Pasco. Bye,
thanks,
TJ.
Pasco.
All right, bye, Brad. Bye. See you later, guys. Thanks, Rob.
Take care.
Take care. Bye, Moet. Let's see the flow, buddy. Let's see the flow. Looking good. Angela, how are you?
Good. You gotta, how are you?
Good. Good to see you. Lauren, you look like you've aged a couple of years. You're getting older and by the second. It's good to see you guys.
Thanks.
Adam, what's going on, buddy? You doing good?
Yeah, I'm Adam, doing all right. Lots of stuff going on.
Oh, that's
good. Oh, there's a flow right there.
It looks like you've got a bunch of pictures on the wall there. What are you?
Oh,
planning a big event or something?
Oh no, it's just things I feel like I need to remember. So I got I've been reading Score for Life, so I got a couple of stuff from there up there. Nice. I got some goal setting stuff and anything I feel like is super important that I hasn't been on top of my mind and I want to make sure I'm really memorized and get down, and that's up there.
That's awesome. That's a really good, that's an awesome book. I have one over by my Peloton, and the book, I started highlighting it. There's so much to highlight that I might as well just highlight the whole book. It's such a good book, but I hope you guys like it. By the way, I'll show you a screen share of the cover of the new book, if I think I have it. It was just finalized here. Let's see. Oh, I thought I had it. I guess I don't. That's okay.
Hey, Pasco.
Yeah.
I do have some questions on the 10 scoring situations.
Oh, 10, yeah.
Yeah, which come through my mind. Like, for example, like the below the goal line situation.
Yeah.
If there's a guy in the corner and he passes out to the slot, is this like, do you still count this like for below the goal line, or is this like a different scenario than for just counting like the goals?
Yeah, you'd count it below the goal line, but you can break it up into a couple of different scenarios. And it's, for example, it could be a below the goal line attack because it's now past the puck from below the goal line to another area. Now, is it going to be a below the goal line attack reception and then a release, below the goal line attack one timer. So okay. What you do is you take below the goal line, that's the macro, and then you micro it. So you'd say, okay, if there's a pass, then you break it down into shot, pass, right?
Yeah.
So you go into shot and go below the goal line, step out shot, below the goal line, carry, step up shot, below the goal line, around the net, jam. So you create all those micro pieces.
Yeah.
And then you'd create your responses beside each of those micro pieces.
Okay.
Okay. Now you could very well say, you can call that a north-south pass as well, couldn't you? Or a south-north pass, whatever you want to call it.
Mm-hmm.
You can call it that too, but in reality, it's where's the origin? The origin is from below the goal line. So when you're below the goal line, you're looking at the puck, so you are not seeing everything that's in front of you. So that's how I would personally define it as a below the goal line attack, because the origin was below the goal line. My focus, my vision is below the goal line. And now I've got to be able to scan for the next most dangerous player and position my body in the event that there is a pass. Right.
Yeah.
And then I have to, yeah, that makes sense. If that helps.
Yeah, it makes sense. And then there's another one, between the above the goal line and the net drive, what's the, like, how do you like
above the goal line and the net drive?
Yeah.
Okay. So above the goal line attack is anything that could be a drive or a shot from above the goal line. That's just in that dead angle zone.
Right. Like the Crosby one, right? With the backhand.
Yeah, exactly. That would be your net drive. Like a jam or a wrap would be plays that are from below the goal line where the player is coming in tight to jam it, mm-hmm. or coming out wide to jam it. So it's how you categorize it as a goalie or as a goalie coach. That's going to make sense to your goalie. Like if I sit with Andrew Hammond and say, how do you want to gauge it? Or if I sit with like Adam Billings and say, how do you want to gauge it? Or Angie or Lauren, I would just say, how do you want to gauge it? Well, to me, it makes more sense to be, I don't care. I'm not going to argue about how they categorize it. I just want them to understand that in their mind, as long as it's clear 2020 vision, then I don't care where they categorize it, but as long as they understand it. Like for me in the new book, I put down 2020 that I go by, scoring situations. And I know Dave Alexander uses in the NHL up to over 30. He uses 32 different scoring situations.
Yeah.
So crazy. Yeah, I mean, that's just all it is going from a macro level to a micro level to a real micro level. Like they're looking at left hand, right hand, you know, one timers, you know, how big their windups are, things like that. And do we need to know that? Like looking at everybody on the screen, I don't think we need to teach young guys that, because they need to understand that they need to scan for the next most dangerous player first. They need to recognize, you know, three major things. Where are they? So what zone, what hand, and are they stationary or moving? If they get those, then let's add more ingredients to the soup, right? Yeah. But if they can't get that, there's no use me vomiting a huge truck load of knowledge, you know, on top of their plate and expect them to learn it. So it's really important. But I use 20. I think 20 is really manageable, but if I sat in front of a goaltender, I probably wouldn't sit there and go, this is the 20 scoring situations. Let's go through each one of them. I would recognize which one that they are not doing a very good job in.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would say, today we're focusing on this situation and work through it. And then at the end of the year, I'd say, I want you to know, hey, this is where we are. This is what we covered. These are all the different areas. Do you remember this day? Yeah. Oh yeah. I remember that. Remember, here's the video that goes with that day. Remember that? And they'll go, oh my God, I can't believe we actually covered 20 scoring situations. So yeah, because they don't need to know essentially in the season what I'm doing, you know, all the details, but they need to know that they've got access to that knowledge. And then when I come out of that, they go, oh my God, I know all of these things. So now they can build their game plan. You know, we can adjust game plan situations as we go through. So that's just managing more career than anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Because once they get in there, they've got so many things going on. Like Lauren, in a couple of years, she's going to be in the NCAA or CIA or U Sport. What'll end up happening is that she's got school, she's got this, she's got that, got all these things going on. Like, it's very important that she plays really well. And if in the off season she wants to understand all those details, she'll you know, when her brain opens up and is rested, they, she'll have the ability to look through and go, oh my God, I know all this stuff. Especially when she looks at a game plan book or is thinking about the sheet, she can see all the different scenarios that happen within that situation, if that makes sense.
Yeah, sounds good. Thanks.
Anything else? No? Carry and shoot. Those are the, that's the most dangerous one. The most dangerous one is carry and shoot. So if guys are carrying the puck and they shoot the puck, got to remember they're moving and then the release, now that's stationary. It's a tough thing to master for sure. So that's number one. And number three is mishap. So that's just throwing pucks to the net. So I don't know how we practice for that other than maintaining our concentration and being as effective as we can in that scenario. Anybody else?
Hey, Pasco. Yep. I just got a non-technical question for you.
Sure.
I think either last week or week before you mentioned you're going to run a program similar to the Monday morning stuff we do in the summer. I don't know if you've talked the Oval or what's going on there, how that's going to work.
I have. We are all set for those weekly sessions. We're also set for the camps that we've got. The problem right now is that I've already put together a social distancing plan and have already submitted it. So they know that we can get started right away. There's nothing that would stop us. The Oval right now has no ice. They got to put the ice in, which takes a few days. Richmond Six has three sheets. So they're going to start opening up in the next little bit. And I think their goal was around the 17th of May to start talking about opening those areas up. So I'm thinking June is going to be when we're going to get back at it. And in May, let's face it, do we really need to get back on the ice right away? Like right now, it's about healing. It's about getting fit. It's about upgrading the athlete. I mean, that's what I've been doing. And Angie, I found that DVD for you. So we should probably hook up. So I'll loan it to you. You can keep it for as long as you need it or copy it and go from there. But right now it's about fitness. It really is about fitness because we don't even know if things are going to start. Like in youth sport, the games are already cut in half. So minor hockey programs don't even know how they're going to run in September. They don't even think that they're going to run that. I'm hosting a program with the Western Hockey League and Hockey Canada for goalie coaches. And like, that's all going to be virtual this year for all the goalie coaches and all the provincial guys. So it's, they don't even know when the hockey season's going to start. Like the hockey season can start in December. So we just have to go one step at a time. But as far as training, like our camps and our one-on-ones, they're going to start up fairly soon. I'd say within the next 3 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks. One-on-ones, which is mainly what we do. There's a lot of social distancing all in its place. And we can run, we have 10 creases on that ice. So there's lots of time, space, and energy. And that could easily be executed. But right now, it's really about fitness.
Do you think the same thing for the ice time will happen for like the Monday mornings that we had too? Will that continue throughout the summer?
Yeah, yes, it will. But in the summer, we want to host those during the day on Thursday. The nights they're easier to get to. Early in the morning on a Monday is not the greatest thing in the world during the summer for parents if they've got time off or whatever it is. So we want to be able to have. The evening time's easy to get to. It'll be a younger group. Let's say your Adam and Pee-wee, and then your Bantam Midget will be your older group. And we'd have two ice sessions. So one for the younger group, one for the older group. And that'll go through from June till August is what the plan is. Yeah.
And you've started doing one-on-ones again?
No.
Or have you not yet?
No, the only one-on-ones that are taking place right now are really at Burnaby Winter Club. And it's really... I've seen what they're doing. It's on the small ice. And I've seen Sean doing them too. And there's also Great Pacific Forum. But if you do Great Pacific Forum, it's quite expensive to do the Great Pacific Forum. So for me to do a one-on-one session, I don't mind doing it, but I don't want to pay $300 an hour for the ice.
Yeah. I've been getting ice at the Summit Center.
In Abbotsford.
Yeah.
What are you doing out there?
So like there's like 8 guys from my team.